Today, I've decided to do a kit build. And I've chosen the traditional, old-school, shake-the-box Athearn flat car. This particular one's undecorated, meaning for the beginners in the crowd, undecorated means not painted, not deckled. However, you can get exactly the same kit pre-painted in a bunch of different road names. Or at least you could. Bought this one, 15 plus years ago for under $7 Canadian. This kit is out of stock at Athearn, but you can get it on eBay for about $12 plus shipping these days. So, what's in the box? The body of the freight car itself. As you can tell, the moldings, there's a mold ejector mark there. Almost nobody runs flat cars around without a load on them. Even though in the real world, 50% of the time or more, you'd see them with no load on them. But in model railroad world, we like our live loads and our open loads. This is a really old school car. It's, got the brake wheel stand, the brake stand up there, riveted. So it's probably going to be 1940s or earlier era, which on my railroad would be a little bit old, but if it's in maintenance duty or something like that, it'll be just fine. At some point I'll paint it, but not today, not for what we're doing here. So anyway, there's the body of the car. Also we have the underframe of the car, the center beam and the bolsters for the trucks and pockets for the couplers. And then we have a piece that goes into the underframe that has the brake bits and pieces on it, brake air tank, brake valve, and brake system part whose name I forget. But it's important, I'm sure. Doesn't matter, don't need to know that. And what do we got in here? A couple of envelopes. This guy. So this, any of the experienced modelers are going to say, you're doing it wrong. That's nothing, that's not the way you do it. Oh, that's just little bits of metal weights. Okay. Set those to the side for now. And this one has two trucks, two horn hook couplers, which I will probably, well, for what I'm doing here, I'll put them in, but I'll replace them with KD couplers before I put them on my railroad, because that's what I've standardized on. There is the brake wheel, and there's two coupler box lids. Okay. Instructions, random piece of cardboard, and the main car weight. And that's it in there. Mm-hmm. So, basic exploded diagram, just showing how everything. Oh, those aren't weights, those are stakes. Okay. That's even better. So I can optionally put them on or not. Those go in the pockets on the side of the car to keep a load of, say, poles or ties or something from sliding off, or pipes. Again, that's before my era. I'm not sure if I'll use them or not, but it's cool to get extra bits and pieces. So, first thing to do, as always, just take a close look, clean up any flash that's in the way. Now, if I was going to be building this properly, normally you would paint the body first before assembling it. But these are so easy to unassemble and reassemble that I don't care. So the weight just drops into there. That weight's a little bit bent. Where's my ruler here? Can you see that? A little bit of an air gap in there. Let's give it an ever so slight straightening it up. This is a chunk of steel. It's nothing magic there. That's better. Okay, so that just drops in under there. Now, the reason I'm doing such a basic car is I notice online, especially in the model railroad forums on Reddit, there's an awful lot of people who are just getting into the hobby and they're completely doing it with ready-to-run cars straight out of the box, which is, or seems to be, the way that the industry is moving as well. There's a little piece of flash there. Just nip that off so that it fits better. There's a little bit there. And it's just a matter of going through and looking for any little bits of flash that will either make it look horrible or will cause the assembly to hang up. X-Acto knife is one of the most useful basic modeling tools for 101 things, and this is definitely one of those. With the number 11 blade, which is the most common one. Okay, so we need to set this in, and which way up does he go? I think it's that way. So it's a little bit of flash that's getting in the way. See that guy there? The other thing that you can use for that is a little file. I got a whole set of these for just a couple of bucks from Princess Auto in the States. That translates to Harbor Freight. Guess since the underside of that isn't super visible. So there that is inserted. That just snapped in there. No glue necessary. I'm going to clean up the backside of this just a little bit more. Anyway, where was I 2 or 3 ramblings ago? I've noticed that a lot of new modelers and the industry are going towards completely ready to run. Just take it out of the box, plop it on the track, way to go. And that's completely valid if you want to operate a railroad. However, a big part of this hobby has always been the model building. And these shake the box kits, which you need a real minimum of tools. Tighten that up. Those guys loosen up over time. These things are a perfect place to get your feet wet. Somebody doing their very first kit wouldn't want an undecorated, probably, because that's just too many different skills that you're throwing into your first project. For your first couple of projects, you just want to get your feet wet, right? So, that, now that I've got all those little bits of flash off, goes under there. One thing to keep in mind, the end of the brake wheel, usually called the B end, and the pointy bit of this brake valve here, I'll just get up closer, the pointy end points towards the brake wheel because the brake wheel pulls a set of rods and levers that pulls on that end right there. So that end, brake wheel's going on here, that end goes that way. It doesn't matter. We're not entering a contest here, but that's just, if you're going to be doing it, you might as well do it for maximum correctness, right? This isn't, okay, so that's not quite fitting properly. Why is that not quite fitting properly? Maybe did I put that guy in upside down? I don't know. Whoop. Try it this way up. Hang on, does it sit a little bit flatter that way? Let's see. Yeah, that sits down better. Okay. Cool. I just learned something. Oh, yeah. I don't know whether you can see it, but on the end of this air tank, there's a little plate with visible rivets there. And on this this guy, which I'm... valve, some sort of a valve, I can't remember exactly. It's also got the same little plates with visible rivets. The back side doesn't have visible rivets. There's the clue I should have spotted earlier. Now that fits all in there nicely. Yeah, so that's that part. What holds it all together? The two screws and the trucks through there that go into the base of the body. Now then, I think normally these trucks come with the wheels loose. I might have done that earlier. But to put them in, you just slightly spread that frame apart. Not so much that it gets a permanent bend, but just ever so slightly. And there it is. Make sure they roll freely. Now this is something that it's a little bit more expensive too, a little bit optional, but it's called an NMRA standards gauge. Glare. And basically it is to help you improve the performance of your cars. So these two notches here are for making sure that the wheels are the correct spacing so that they'll sit in the track properly. That one's a little bit narrow. So I'll just grab the two of them. I'll just pull that out. So basically two plastic wheels on a steel shaft. Just grab the two ends and pull them apart slightly twisting. I know it was hard to see, but there now. That sits into there better. And the point of that is you don't want them so tight or so wide or so loose that they don't sit properly on the tracks. You want them to roll nice and smoothly with a little bit of gap between the flanges and the rails, but not too much. You don't want them falling down in there, but you don't want them pinching tight so they ride up like that either. There is also on the gauge a set of gauges for the track, and basically it just sits between those two little points there. If it's too tight, then that one won't go down in there. If it's too loose, this one will fall down into the gutter. For track that you buy, that's not usually an issue. If you're handling track or if you're adjusting track, especially at turnouts, that's really, really useful. What else is on there? Point spacing. We'll look at that later. Flange ways. And... here is platform height and tunnel clearance, and the whole thing is what the railroads call plate C, which is basically a tunnel clearance gauge. As long as you can slide that through your tunnels, then your trains aren't going to clip the edges or hit the roof or whatever. And then there's a coupler height gauge down there. Super duper useful, a little bit expensive, one time buy, something you'll never regret having. Anyway, so divergence aside, there's the wheel back in. Just make sure they spin nice and freely. Quickly check this other guy. That's all right. Now that I mentioned, these are plastic wheels. Normally I go with metal wheels on mine. You can buy replacement sets in different sizes. And again, like everything else around here, these things are decades old. I don't know if this brand is still available. I know KD used to make them. Proto 2000 made them, and they were a relatively reasonable price, as model railroad stuff goes. Anybody getting into this hobby is going to know real quick that it's expensive. But by building kits, you're also going to find that it's less expensive than buying them ready to run. So that's another thing that you can do. So these wheels just sit on the bolster there and thread in. But I'm not going to do that right yet because we've still got couplers to mount. And so these are the horn hook couplers, standard for decades, standard train set coupler. I'm just going to put them on for now, but I'm going to replace them later, like you're going to do an upgrading video. So these little coupler box covers or cover plates, you can see there, it just goes on like that. The for these things, if you are going to use them, the trip pin points towards the ground. And these little covers, the wide end goes away from the car. And that literally just clips on there. And there it is. Okay, and put the other one on. The only thing you need to make sure is that the hole comes up through there. There it is. Okay. Now then we can screw the trucks on. There's a flat side up here and a dished side there. It goes on with the flat side facing the car. And I'm going to grab some tweezers here. In there. Okay, screw it down. You want it so that it doesn't rock too hard. Right now it's rocking pretty hard, but you also don't want it so tight that it won't move. There, that's a reasonable balance. It still pivots sideways. There's only got a little bit of rock on it. Actually, this one, drop the screw in there first. Trying to do this to camera is a little bit trickier. Cameraman. If the car would sit flat with without that brake wheel stand, then this might be a little bit easier too, but. So there she goes, that's reasonable. One rolling car, last piece. The brake wheel. And we do actually need some glue for this one. I didn't think we did. But first I'm just gonna dry fit it. Make sure there's no flash bunging up that hole. Goes in there nicely. Okay, actually that is pretty tight. But I am going to just put a little drop of glue. And actually this is solvent type glue, not the, which is nice and smelly. That guy's on there. Basically what it's going to do, rather than just stick pieces together like cement or something, it actually melts the plastic a little bit into each other. And there it is. Now that coupler is a little bit tight. Just adjust it up a little bit. Okay. One basic, simple freight car. And in less than 20 minutes, even with all my rambling on, if that was the painted, pre-painted version, it would already be on the railroad. Oh, yeah, the stakes. If you choose to put the stakes in the pockets, they just slide in. And that keeps your load from falling off. Oh, what's happened to that coupler? That coupler box lid came off. So, what's happened here? It's a little bit splayed, so I'm just going to Give it just gentle bend in. And I'll quickly repair this. That's the other good thing about these kits. You built it, so you know how it goes together. You know where all the parts go. So if something screws up and you break it somehow, you know how to fix it. That little spring that keeps it centered in there. There we go. Okay, that guy's in there now. Truck back on quickly. Sure, I'm rushing and I'm being stupid about this. But anyway, you get the idea. Right, so the stakes, the point of the stakes, as I mentioned earlier, is when you've got a load, obviously you're going to tie down your load, but for a second here, if you have a load that is kind of rolly, like say a load of pipes, that's going to hold them mostly in place, and then you'll throw a piece of chain or rope or string or something across them, which would also tie down into the stakes. Let's get a pretend piece of metal cable here, which in this, just run it over and through into the stake pocket to hold your load down, and the stakes will keep it from rolling off just in case you have a failure. And there it is. I hope that was useful to some of you, especially I hope it inspires some of the beginning railroaders to try their hands at one of these simple kits. They really are that easy, and you don't need many tools. A little screwdriver could be any kind. The pliers are optional. Tweezers, I mean, these ones are out of five different shapes of tweezers from, again, Princess Auto or Harbor Freight. If you're in the States, cheap set of files, X-Acto knife, that's something that you'll find a million uses for. And the standard gauge, while not necessary, is something that you will find a million uses for throughout your motor railroading life. That's it for now. Bye.